Hey everyone, welcome to FTO Nerd Talks. Today we are interviewing Jason Barrett of JBN Comics. Jason, welcome.
Ah, great to be here, man. Thank you for having me.
No problem. Thanks for being on. So you have recently released two comics, Hiru, and we'll get to talking all about him in a moment. But first, let's talk about you. You have an interesting story, origin story, if you want to say that. Would you mind sharing that with us and telling us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, so basically I'm from London, England, born in London, was raised here, raised in a single parent household with mum. And I started out in the church actually, and kind of got, you know, the degree in theology and was doing that whole thing, went into the pulpit for a little while, and then kind of got this, I don't know what the word is, but I suppose I just, it didn't make sense to me anymore. Let's call it that. And kind of went down a bit of an interesting path, got involved in crime, and ended up in prison. And I was in a supermax prison here for a year, Belmarsh Prison, on for possession of a firearm. And so I was sentenced to 6.5 years. And in the UK, when you're sentenced, you do sort of half that time. So I did 3 years, 3 months. And then the rest you do on what they call probation, where, you know, you sort of check in and stuff. And it was actually in prison where I sort of started really, I mean, I've always been into script writing and that type of thing, but you've got a lot of time on your hands and a lot of time to think. And so, yeah, perfect time to, like, it's a bit like quarantine, perfect time to start writing, you know. And so I started kind of penning Heru there.
That's awesome.
So sort of.
Yeah, sort of. Yeah, I mean, that you use that time to do something.
Yes, yeah, that's right.
That part is awesome. Wow, that's interesting. So have you always been a lover of comics?
Always. I think my first comic was around 8 years old. And I remember just seeing a copy of The Mighty Thor on a newsagent, like a newsstand near my church, actually. And I remember just harassing my mum to buy it for me, you know. And it was actually number 330.
Remember the issue.
Yeah, because awesome. He fights a guy called the Crusader. I just remember that. I remember that front cover, and I remember thinking, I just wanted that, you know. And again, I think it was to do with being in church and seeing that cross. And just that imagery, you know, and ever since then, I've been just, you know, the lover of comics, Thor in particular. But yeah, Superman, and, you know, it kind of spreads out after that. But yeah, so I've been sort of 7, 8 years old around that sort of time.
That's awesome. So are you reading comics now other than your own? What do you read?
Yeah. Still reading Thor. So I'm now looking at Thor, Herald of Galactus at the moment, and you know, King Thor with these new powers and stuff. I do you know what though? I tend to read a lot of the older stuff as well. It's only if friends tell me about the new stuff I kind of get involved. Yeah, it's you know, I read a thing recently and you know, The Boys.
Yeah,
had like a TV series. So then I went back and started reading those comics, and then there was not Indestructible. There was another one that I read, sort of another indie one, which is, you know, got this kind of rogue Superman character, and so yeah, I kind of get involved like that. But I'm still old school with it. I'm still Silver Surfer days, you know. I'm still old school.
That's awesome. So what inspires you about comics, and what inspired you ultimately to take that love of comics and create your own?
Do you know what? I think initially, why I really gravitated to Thor was, I was in church. I've grown up in church all my life, you know, church every day, Sunday school. And we used to read the King James version of the Bible, which is very thou, thee, thy, and all of that. And Thor spoke like that. And so I think there was some sort of connection there with that sound, that way of speaking that I really liked. And I really loved the stories, the ideas of heroes, you know. I think they kind of represent the better us ultimately, you know. And I think, you know, and give us that thing to strive for. So I think that's really the inspiration for me. And it was a way of escape as well, man. Like, you know, we grew up in the projects, what you guys would call the projects. We call it the estates. And it was just like, you know, it was literally cars drop, police car sirens and that sort of thing. And in the comic book world, it was brilliant. You know, the bad guys lost, the good, it's how it's supposed to be. The
right,
good guys
win, the bad guys.
You know, this is how it's supposed to be. So so I think it was that escapism as well. And I've always enjoyed that, whether it's been in TV or whatever. I've always loved that.
Nice. Very cool. So let's break down Hiru a little bit. To tell us about him, tell us about the story so far, and maybe what's coming next.
Okay, so Hiru is a five-part series. So we're on, I've just finished book three. So nice. One and two are out, book three's done. And it's basically the story of, it was just me asking the question. So Marvel have a really great a title, What If?
Yep. Yeah, yeah.
What If? This, what if Rogue, not Rogue, what if Storm had took over Asgard? What if this? And so for me, it was a what if during slavery, there was a Superman? You know, what yeah. if we had a Superman during slavery? It was just asking that question and then trying to answer it, thinking, what would the world be like now? You know, and so I kind of went back and thought, you know, let's do it. And let's do it in a way that, the Greek god Horus is the Egyptian deity Heru, the same deity, just different names.
Yep.
And so I thought, and my study showed that the word Heru and hero have the same root. So Egyptian influences, I think it's Greek influenced by Roman, Latin, English, we get to hero, yeah? And so for me, it was like, wow, that's cool. So, you know, the first hero is Heru. And yeah. basically how I've kind of built that was this guy kind of, you know, in a situation, he's in pre-Civil War America, he's on a plantation, and it's basically having suffering lots of abuse. What does he do with that power? Because with great power comes great responsibility.
Right.
And so it was kind of trying to tell the story and not trying to use it as a revenge tool. Yeah, let's start killing white people, you know?
Yeah.
which most people see the front cover or see the tagline, what if during slavery we had a Superman? And that's the assumption that they make straight away. Mm. And so it's kind of, but that's not the hero's way. And I think it is important to try and still stick within the frameworks of what is the hero's way. So I think, and I also love the fact that Superman, you know, Superman and Captain America both fought Nazis, you know? So it was that idea of injecting a little bit of history with a little bit of, you know, fiction and fantasy and superhero-dom and seeing kind of what will come up. And yeah, and that was born Heru.
That's awesome. I've read both issues so far. I've loved them. And I'm not going to give anything away, but I love the tension he has right now between doing what he feels he needs to do and versus what he's maybe being called to do. So
yes.
I love it. So why I'm okay. So let's be frank. You're not from America. we can tell.
Yeah.
Why set your story in pre-Civil War America?
So if when you read Harry's fact file, he's actually from Jamaica originally. Right. So that's where he was born, on a plantation in Jamaica. So, you know, the British were, you know, very involved in the slave trade, and the British were very in the islands mainly, though. So the British have kind of, Britain never gets a bad name for the slave trade in the same way that America does, even though they were just as involved. But it's because Britain did all of their slavery on the islands, not on the mainland.
Right.
And so you haven't got that same energy, whereas the American slavery took place on the mainland. And so I kind of wanted to link the two worlds. I wanted to link the fact that it was all one community, this kind of slave-owning families, that it was all one thing. And also, America's got, from a business perspective, America's got a bigger marketplace. You know, in the UK, there is a population of 68 million people. And out of that, only 1.2 million are African, Black, Afro-Caribbean, whereas America's more like 35 million upwards, probably even more than that, African-Americans. And so there was that whole thing. And again, I've got, America's done such a fantastic job of exporting her culture. And so when you think of the slave trade, you instantly think of Roots or 12 Years a Slave or, you know, those kind of things.
Yeah.
And I think part of the thing I wanted to do as well was bring together genres. America loves slave movies, and strangely enough, in particular Black Americans, go figure. And America also loves superheroes. So why not bring these things together, you know? And I just don't think it would have worked in the islands, in Jamaica or so on and so forth. And it wouldn't have been realistic in the UK on the, you know, in mainland England. So America was the best choice.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. Perfect sense. So speaking of a Black audience, I would say, at least the opinion of a white guy here, that you're part of a resurgence of Black indie comics right now. If you're looking everywhere, there's all these new Black-owned, Black-created, Black-drawn titles coming out, and it's awesome. Do you have any other indie titles that you're following in that genre right now?
Yes, absolutely, I do. There's so many at the moment, and it's the funny thing is, you know, the Instagram and these social media things have just changed. I was like, what, other people are doing this? You know, I thought it was only me. I had this idea, god damn it, but it's brilliant. So there's these guys called Concrete Comics with a K. They do The Absolver, they do Adina the Baddest, and they do Acolyte. So I'm loving their stuff at the moment. There's another guys that are out there, and I think they're from New York, Webway Comics, and they do this thing called It's Nana. It's Nana is like a take on the Anansi story.
The Were Spider, yeah.
Yes,
yeah, I love them. Were
Spider, there you go. Yeah. So yeah, those guys as well, I'm finding them pretty cool. The guys that did Black as well, which was, you know, the only thing I didn't like about Black was I'm not the biggest fan of black and white comic books, personally.
Yeah.
You know, I like color books. I like those kind of vibrant colors.
Yeah.
And back in the day, in the 90s, 1993, there was, what are they called? They did Heru as well. They did Heru. They did
The Association of African Comic Publishers.
ANEA. ANEA. There you go. Boom. Yeah. Well, I just managed to track down one of those guys that were involved in that. The guy that did Purge.
Really?
He's
republishing right now. I just got his latest books. Yeah.
That's right. So, So I've kind of just got involved with him as well and trying to get that stuff because,
Awesome.
Yeah,
brilliant. Sounds like our read pile is basically the same right now. Like we're reading the same stuff. That's awesome.
Yeah. No, it's crazy, man. So yeah, it's a brilliant time. It really is.
Yeah. Have you read any of the Harriet Tubman Demon Slayer?
No, but I've seen those, and I'm trying to get my hands on some of those. Because the problem that I have is getting them shipped here is so expensive. You know, it's like sometimes more than the comic book itself to get it shipped. Yeah. So that's the only struggle that I'm having. But I have seen those, and those are looking cool. Any good?
Yeah, they're great. And I'm secretly hoping for someday a Hiru and Harriet Tubman crossover. So just keep that in mind, okay?
I like it. Let's put it out there. Let's do it.
All right, so you are having, I would say, success. I'm seeing you kind of start to pop up everywhere on Instagram with the titles. You have an audiobook that just came out of the Hiru titles. What advice would you give others who are wanting to get into the indie comic industry?
I think the first thing is I always say start by starting. You know, a lot of the time what we end up doing is talking about what we're going to do, you know, and I'm going to do this, and it's always down the road somewhere, and I think just get on with it. You know, there's a lot of guys out there that are writers and they think, oh, I can't draw. I'm not very good at drawing. So I can't draw, you know. I literally, when I came home, I bought How to Draw Comics by Stan, the Marvel way, by Stan and Jack Kirby. And I sat down and just worked on the shapes, you know, just to kind of get my rough storyboard together. And then you bring in a better drawer, you know, you bring in an illustrator, you bring in a colorist to kind of do your stuff. So I think just don't let those little obstacles get in the way. And also when you're budgeting on the business side of it, make sure that if your book's going to cost you $10,000 to bring to print, to get a finished job, make sure you've got another $10,000 to do your marketing and advertising. Because what we as independents always do is we spend every penny we've got on getting the product done, and then we've got an amazing product, but we've got no money left to market. No one ever hears about it. You know, we sort of try and sell it to our friends and family and realize that when all of them have bought it, we've only made $100. I thought I had more friends and family, you know. You know, it's like, it's so, I think that's one of the big trip ups, you know, in all honesty, is that the marketing and, you know, the creativity is always there, but the taking it as a business, because, you know, it is a business, you know, and it has to be treated as such. And I think for me, that's kind of been the biggest struggle, because I've got all these great ideas. And now it's like, now you need to figure a way of getting them to market and getting them in front of people. So I'm glad that, you know, things like this let me know, okay, it's actually starting to work, you know, that we're getting it out there.
That's awesome. That's awesome. So tell people where they can find your work at. How if they want to buy a copy or get the audiobook, where do they do that?
So website, www.herucomics.com. Boom. Just nice and simple. We're on Instagram as JBEON, JBEON _comics. And that's me there. So if you holler, you know, I respond. I might not be do it straight away, but I will get back to people. I always respond. So yeah, you know, and always up to collabing. I'm always looking for artists and so on and so forth. So yeah, no doubt, man. Just holler at me.
That's awesome. Well, everybody, you heard him. You can go grab his comics right now and download them like I did and read them right now. They're great. And I encourage you to grab your copies of Heru and follow Jason on Instagram and all his other channels. We'll talk to you guys later. Thanks, Jason. Thanks for being here again.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me, man.
No problem.